So, what all we discussed in our previous session, we looked at what are hash functions, we looked at the application of hash functions, the properties of a good hash function. We also looked at how we use hash functions in message authentication, digital signatures, password protection, and virus detection. Finally, we winded up understanding the security requirements of hash functions. In that session, I was talking to you about this particular hash function SHA-1, which is nothing but secure hash algorithm 1. Whereas we are going to learn about SHA-512, which is a predecessor of SHA-1, and it comes under the series of hash functions given the name SHA-2. So today's lecture is all about SHA-512, and we'll understand SHA-512. Even before going into SHA-512, we'll understand the history of secure hash algorithms. Just a brief history. So this algorithm, secure hash algorithm, was proposed in 1993 by the US government standards agency, that is called National Institute of Standards and Technology. So once when they published this in 1993, after a brief period of time, they have withdrawn that. So that is called SHA-0. So initial algorithm was withdrawn. It had a small error or a flaw. And then they republished it after a revision, and that is called SHA-1. So SHA-0 was immediately revised and published as SHA-1. And SHA-1, what is this SHA-1? It will take a variable length message. If you pass it to the hash algorithm, say this is H and you pass M to it, the output will be a fixed size 160 bits. Or we can say 40 digit hexadecimal. Why it is 40 digit hexadecimal? Because each hexadecimal character takes 4 bits, so it's totally 160 bits. So this was SHA-1, and it produces a 160 bit hash value, also known as a message digest. Say this output is known as the hash value, or it can also be called as the message digest. But in 2005, they found that SHA-1 is no more secure. They found that it is insecure for certain issues. And as of 2010, many organizations have recommended its replacement. So NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology in US, they formally depreciated the use of SHA-1. They said, we'll not use SHA-1 anymore. And in 2013, they said, we'll not be using SHA-1 for digital signatures. So SHA-1 is depreciated. And there was this predecessor for SHA-1, that is SHA-2, that came up. And SHA-2 is a family of 6 hash functions, actually. We have 6 hash functions. And what are those hash functions? It's SHA-224, SHA-256, SHA-384, and SHA-512, like that. And we'll see some differences here. Say when I say SHA-512, the hash function will give me an output of 512 bits. Whereas SHA-1, what was the output? It was just 160 bits. Likewise, SHA-224 will give me an output of 224 bits. The message digest that is getting generated was different. And we also have significant differences here. So we'll be looking at SHA-512. We'll be looking at this particular variation of secure hash algorithm in today's class. So if you are able to understand SHA-512, SHA-1 is just pretty simple, because these algorithms are built on the same foundations, but have been improvised for security reasons. So SHA-512 secure hash algorithm, that is the discussion. We'll understand the overall view of SHA-512. So we take this input message. This input message can be any varied length message or variable length message. We are giving it to this hash function called SHA-512. And it's going to give us an hash value. The size of the hash value is 512 bits. And we say this is a one-way function, because using this 512 bits hashed value, we'll never be able to get back our input message. So that is the property of a good hash function, right? So it should always be this side, and whereas we should not be able to compute the text message from our hash value. So this is the overview. And we have to understand certain things. We'll be doing certain things to our input message, and we'll be understanding how SHA-512 actually converts an input message to 512 bits. Whatever be the input message size, finally we'll get 512 bits. We'll see how it works. So first thing is, we'll take this input message. Input message can be anything, any size, and we'll be sending it through a process called padding. We'll be padding some more bits to the input message such that our output is divided into 1024 bit blocks. So our input message is broken down into blocks. So each block is of 1024 bits, and so we'll have n into 1024 bits. So we'll have n blocks, each of size 1024. So the key thing here is, if even our input message is only 24 bits, what is the requirement? This 24 bits message should be padded. Padding in the sense, adding some ones and zeros, adding zeros at the end. And then it should be converted, that 24 bits should be converted to a 1024 bit block. Only then this can be used with our SHA-512 hash function. So we'll take a look at what is padding with an example. So let us consider an input message to be ABC, and how will you represent this message in binary? This is for A, this is for B, this is for C, 8 bits for each value here. So what is the message length we have here? 24 bits. But for a SHA-512 function, we need an input of how many bits? The message length should be minimum these many bits. That is, needed message length should be congruent to 896 mod 1024. So this is a requirement. When you're going to have a message length for SHA-512, it should satisfy this criteria, standard criteria. What is that? Message length should be congruent to 896 mod 1024. That means we have a message length of 24 should be congruent to 896 mod 1024. But what is 896 mod 1024? That is only 896. We can very well write this like this, right? 24 mod 1024 should be equal to 896. But we know 24 mod 1024 is only 24. This is not equal to 896. So based on whatever message length we have here, this property is not satisfied. So how to satisfy this property? When we take this value and do a mod 1024, it should be 896. So how we can satisfy this property is, what I will do is, I'll take 24, I will add that with 872, and then I'll perform mod 1024. What is 24 plus 872? 896 mod 1024. What is 896 mod 1024? 896. So why I am adding 872 bits here? So that the result will be equal to 896. Why it should be equal to 896? Because that is the standard requirement here. So how many bits I have to add? 872 bits I have to add. So I have also given that as a type message here. So we can very well write message length mod 1024 is equal to 896, and we have understood 24 mod 1024 is not 896. So how we can solve this problem is, we can add 872 bits to 24 so that our final result will be 896. But what do you mean by 872 bits? It's nothing but adding a bit 1 followed by 871 zeros. So it's like this. This is my message. I'll add a 1 bit, that is a 1 here, followed by all zeros, 871 zeros I'm going to pad. So that is the meaning. You add a bit 1 and then you followed by 871 zeros. So when you take a look at our message, what will be the message? This is the input message. After padding, how it will convert is, it will convert to something like this. Let me erase all the ink on the slide. Okay, it's not that. Erase all ink on the slide. Okay. So this is our output message. It is in hexadecimal. And what is the output message size? It is 896 bits. So we'll see how this is derived from this. You take 4 bits because we are representing this in hexadecimal. What is 0110? That is 6. What is 000? I mean these 4 bits, 0001, so that is 1. Likewise, this is 01110, that is a 6, and the next 4 bits correspond to a 2, and the next 4 bits correspond to a 6, and the next 4 bits correspond to a 3, right? So 3. But what is this 8 here? That's what I told you. How will you pad 872 bits? You will have a bit 1 added and all zeros, right? We'll add 871 zeros here. So one bit is a 1. So next 4 bits is nothing but 1000, that is given as 8. And the remaining all hexadecimal values will be 0 because 4 zeros, 4 zeros like that. So finally, you have your 896 bits represented like this in hexadecimal. That is the first step in padding. We take 24 bits, we satisfy this requirement and derive 896 bits. We are not yet done with padding. We will now go and take a look at what we are going to add here. This is totally how many bits we have? 896, right? After padding 871 zeros and 1 bit to be a 1, this is in hexadecimal. We have some free space here. We should add something here. For that, what we'll do is we'll take the original length of the message and convert that to 128 bits. What is this original length of the message? That is 24 bits. 8 plus 8, that is 24 bits. We'll convert this to hexadecimal. What is 24 in hexadecimal? Who can compute me and tell me the value? So you have 24. How will you convert that to hexadecimal? So base 16. 16 into 1 is 16, remainder is 8. So in hexadecimal, 24 is 18. That's how you represent that. So hexadecimal value of 24 is 18 here. And this can be represented in 128 bits hexadecimal value. That is given like this. So this is 18. This corresponds to 64 bits. Okay, this 8 and this 1 hexadecimal, and then we are going to have all zeros, so all are hexadecimal values. So what we have done here is taking the 128 bits that we can pad here, and then we are just adding the message length, original message length in hexadecimal. So this is our final message after that padding. We arrived 896 bits from a previous slide. And what is this? This is nothing but the message length, that is 128 bits. Why I say it is 128? Each one is a 4 bit hexadecimal value here. So this is 64 bits, this is 64 bits, and this is the message length in hexadecimal, that is nothing but 24 is converted to hexadecimal and represented here. So finally, when you add 896 bits, you add, right? How many bits you have added extra? 896 plus 128. That is what you have added here. What is 896 plus 128? Can you tell me? 896 plus 128 will be 1024 bits. So that is the key here. We take in a message size of 24 bits, and then we pad zeros, and then we add the length of the message in hexadecimal for 128 bits, and then we derive a message size of 1024 bits. You understood why we did 1024? Because our output should be 1024. We took a message size of 24, padded, added the length, and then we made it 1024. That's how it's happening internally. Now this is an exercise for you. How many bits you will pad for an input message length of 2348 bits? It's not that message should always be less than 1024, right? A message can be anything, it can vary. So if I have an input of 2348 bits, how many bits should I pad? or how many blocks, or I can ask you how many blocks of 1024 bits I am going to get. So you have 2348 bits here. What is the criteria in SHA-512? The message length should be congruent to 896 mod 1024. So what is this message length being congruent to 896 mod 1024? 2348 mod 1024 should be equal to 896. But what is 2348 mod 1024? This is 300. So if I want the remainder to be equal to 896, what I should do here? I should add 596 so that I'll get a remainder of 896. So how many bits I should be adding to 2348? I should be adding 596 bits. So 2348 plus 596 mod 1024 gives me 896. So this is the requirement that we have to satisfy. But initially 2348 mod 1024 gave me only 300. So that was not equal to 896. To make it equal to 896, I have added plus 596. So 2348 plus 596 mod 1024 is equal to 896. So how many bits we are going to pad? 596 bits. So it's going to be a 1 bit, that is 1, followed by all 595 zeros. Got it? So what is the message length? Now 2348 plus 596 will be nothing but 2944 bits. After this, what we have to do? We have to take the message length and convert it to hexadecimal and add it as a 128 bit message to our, pad it as a 128 bit message to our message that we have generated here. The next step is add the message length 2348 as 128 bits at the end. So you convert 2348 to hexadecimal and store it as 128 bits at the end. So what is 2944 plus 128? That is our final message size, that is 3072. Got it? So we finally arrive at a message that is of length 3072. And how you can divide it by 1024? When you divide it by 1024, you're going to get 3 blocks. So we are going to have 3 blocks of each 1024 bits. That's how padding works. So I've taken one example for a size that is lesser, another example for a size of the message that is greater than 1024. So let me repeat it. We have 2348 bits. The criteria here is 2348 mod 1024 should be equal to 896. But actual value of this operation is only 300. To make it equal to 896, I'm just adding 596. So now 2348 plus 596 mod 1024 will be equal to 896. So how many bits I'm going to pad? Bit 1 and then 595 zeros at the end of 2348. So if your message length is 2348 bits, I'll add 1 and 595 zeros. That is the meaning. So what is the total message length we arrive at? That is 2348 plus 596, 2944 bits. There is another thing that we have to do. We have to pad a 128 bits at the end. What is this 128 bit all about? It's all about the length converted in hexadecimal. So what is 2944? The final message length will be 2944 plus 128. That is nothing but 3072. I'm sorry for that. 3072. And 3072 can be divided into 3 blocks of each 1024 bits. Quite interesting. I hope you have understood this. That's about padding. And that's what we have arrived at here. Let me remove all this ink on the slide. So you get an input message of 2348 bits. You pad 596 bits with 1 bit and 595 zeros plus a 128 bit message length. So you're going to get how much? 3072, which is divided as 3 blocks, M1, M2, M3 of 1024 bits. Now let us take a look at the overall block diagram of SHA-512. So from a previous slide, we have understood that we are breaking the input message into blocks of 1024 bits. Let us consider we have 3 blocks of 1024 bits here. This is block 1, block 2 and block 3. And what we do is we take a block of 1024 bits, we feed it to a module. This you consider to be a module. For now, we'll assume it to be like a black box. And this module takes in an initialization vector of 512 bits. So this is a random value of 512 bits, which is fed into this module. And it is represented as A, B, C, D, E, F, G. So each letter here corresponds to 64 bits. So 64 into 8 will get 512 bits. And this is how they look. Say these are some of the initial values we assume and we take up for A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. And it's represented in hexadecimal here. So each is of 4 bits. So we have 16 digits of hexadecimal character. So each value is of 64 bits. And we have almost 8 values like that. So 64 into 8 will have 512 bits. So 512 bits of this initialization vector is being fed to this module. Let me erase the ink on the slide. And the output from this module is performed an addition with the initialization vector. So the output here will be 512 bits, and this will be added with this initialization vector H0. And the addition here is, it is nothing but addition modulo 2 power 64. So it's not XOR operation, it's not an XOR, it is addition modulo 2 power 64. Say it's very simple. What is 2 plus 3 mod 2 power 3? So this is addition modulo 2 power 3. What is 2 plus 3? It is 5. Mod 2 power 3 is 8. 5 mod 8 is 5. So if you take a larger value here, what is 5 plus 5 mod 2 power 3? It is nothing but 10 mod 2 power 3, which is 8. 10 mod 8 is nothing but the remainder is 2. So if the value exceeds 2 power 3, we are just going to remove that value and then we are just going to give the remainder. That is the concept. The same thing applies here. It's nothing but addition modulo 2 power 64 is nothing but you add two numbers and perform mod 2 power 64. So that is the concept of addition in SHA-512. So what addition we are performing here is addition modulo 2 power 64. Let me erase the other things. And after addition, we are going to get this output, which will also be 512 bits. And that becomes H1. And now in the next step, we take M2, the next block of 1024 bits. We use the same module F. And for this module, now the initialization vector will be H1 that was computed in the previous step. So we pass that. And the output of this module will be performed. We will have an addition being performed with H1. The output of this module will be added to H1, and this addition is addition modulo 2 power 64, and this output is again 512 bits and it is called H2. Now we'll take block 3 and then we'll feed H2 as the vector here, and then this output will be added to H2, and we'll finally get H3, which will be of 512 bits, and this is called message digest. So what we understand here is we have taken 3 blocks of input message, each 1024, that is we had 3072 bits coming in. We were continuously feeding them to this module, which is a black box kind of stuff. And we were also having this initial buffer, that is A, B, C, D, E, F, G, initialized to certain values and then it was fed to this module. With this we generated our buffer and we use that in our next module, and then likewise we were propagating this value of the buffer until we reached the last block of text, and then we were able to generate message digest or the hash value of 512 bits. So no matter what is the length of a message, the output will always be 512 bits in SHA-512. So this is the overall block diagram of SHA-512. So what all we have to understand from this block diagram is, we need to understand what is this module F. What exactly are the functionalities of this particular module F? So in module F, let us take a look at step one, that is called message scheduling. We are going to take a single block of 1024 bits, and then we are going to expand it, or we are going to generate words. So word 0, word 1, word 2, like that, we'll go up till word 79. So taking a message block of 1024 bits, we are going to generate words starting from word 0 to word 79, and each word is 64 bits. So we are going to generate 80 words, that is the concept, and each word will be 64 bits. So in advanced encryption standard, we are looking at key expansion, something like that. Here we are taking the message of 1024 bits, and then we are expanding it like this from word 0 to word 79. The next thing that we are going to look at is how to derive 80 words from a block of 1024 bits. So we have this message block. Let's say we have M1, which is 1024 bits. Using M1, we can very well derive word 0 to word 15. We can get 16 words from our input text block, and each word will be of 64 bits. So word 0 to word 15 is readily available to us from this block M1 of 1024 bits. That is what is this diagram saying here. And to generate this next word, word 16, what all words we need and what is the concept we are going to apply is given here. So word 16 can be derived using word 0, which is available to us. Word 1 is also available to us. Word 9 is also available to us, and word 14 is also available to us. So we're going to use word 0. Word 1 is going to be fed to a function sigma 0, and word 14 will be fed to a function sigma 1. Word 9 will be used. The addition of all these things gives us word 16. So now the question comes, what is sigma 0? What is sigma 1? What are these functions? Before going and taking a look at the functions, let us take a look at the formula for computing the word. So word t is equal to sigma 512 of wt minus 2 plus wt minus 7 plus sigma 512 of wt minus 15 plus wt minus 16. So what it says is, if I want to compute word 16, if t is 16, if I want to compute word 16, I should pass sigma 512, a function will take up word 16 minus 2, that is word 14. So I am passing word 14 to this function sigma 512. That is what is given here. Plus wt minus 7, that is word 16 minus 7 is word 9. Plus, and again I have to use this function sigma 512, and then I have to pass this word 16 minus 15, that is word 1. So word 1 will be given to this function, that is the meaning. And word t minus 16 will be added. What is word t minus 16? So word 16 minus 16 is nothing but word 0. So to determine any word, we just apply that in this expression, we'll be able to find that word. So I told you how to find word 16. When I take t to be 16, I know w of 16 is nothing but sigma 512 of w14 plus w9 plus sigma 512 of w1 plus w0. So it is also given diagrammatically here. So we have understood how to generate a word from a given set of words, but we have to understand what these functions are. Let us now take a look at this function, sigma 512 0. We'll understand what this one does. Then we'll understand what this function sigma 512 one does. So this function sigma 5120 takes in a word as an input. So what is the word that's going in here? That is word 16 minus word 15, word 1. So 64-bit word is fed as the input. And what this function does with this word? So it takes that word, performs a right circular shift of 1 bit. And again takes the same word, performs a right circular shift of 8 bits. And again takes that word, performs a left shift of 7 bits and adds zeros in the right. So the word is taken and it is right circular shifted by 1 bit, 8 bit, and then left shifted by 7 bits. The values are then XORed with each other. So what is this ROT here? It is rotate right. Or right circular shift. You all know what is right circular shifting, right? For instance, if x is equal to 10111, if you perform a right circular shift, that is represented as ROTR, rotate right x by 1 bit. What does that mean? We're just going to take this byte, bring it here. That is rotate right by 1 bit. So after this operation, x will be 11011. The same kind of a concept here. So we are rotating right x by 1 bit, rotating right x by 8 bits, and left shifting x by 7 bits, and we are XORing all these values. So we have understood what is sigma 512x. Now we'll look at sigma 5121x. What does that perform? So it's something very similar like this function. So we take the value of x and we rotate it by 19 bits to the right. Likewise, we perform a circular right shift of x by 61 bits and we shift left x by 6 bits and then we XOR all the results so that we get the value for this particular function, that is sigma 1512x. So now we know how to compute these two functions, we'll be able to get the result of our word. So WT can be computed now, because we know what is sigma 5121 and sigma 5120. So since we know these things, the other things are directly from our input text message. We know what is WT minus 7 and WT minus 16. So the general computation of the word is also given in a diagram here. So this expression you're seeing here is given here as a diagram. So to summarize, how will you generate a word? You will use the previous four words, that is word t minus 16, you'll take word t minus 15 and pass it to sigma 0512, and we know what is sigma 0512, what it does to that word, and we'll use wt minus 7. This wt minus 7 is from our input message block, and wt minus 2 is again from the input message block, but we'll feed it to our function sigma 1512 of x, and then the results will be added here. This addition is nothing but addition modulo 2 power 64, and that's how we take a block of 1024 bits and compute 80 words from it. In the last slide, we were looking at how to expand our message. Say we have 1024 bits that is coming in, that block, that is expanded to 80 words each of size 64 bits. Now in this slide, we'll be taking an in-depth look at what is this F. So what is happening inside this module F? So this exactly explains what is happening inside module F. To even more perfectly map what is happening inside F, I'll just draw it here. So this is the exact expansion of F. So this module F contains 80 rounds, round 0 to round 79, and each round takes in a word. So we have 80 words which we've already expanded in our previous slide. And every round also takes in a round constant. And we have 80 round constants starting from K0 to K79. So this is what is happening inside F. And what is the input that is going into F? Can you recollect? So this is the overall block diagram, right? So for F, what is the input? We have 1024 bits of message that's coming in. So that is happening here, 1024 bits coming in and is expanded to 80 words and fed into each round. What is the another input F? This initialization vector that is being fed. So for now, we'll understand our entire process for this particular block alone. We'll take this block M1 and we'll see how module F works for our input block M1. So what is the input to F here? It is an initialization vector, and this is represented as A, B, C, D, E, F, G. And we have taken some initial values in this buffer A, B, C, D, E, F, G. That is exactly this A, B, C, D, E, F, G. What is this A, B, C, D, E, F, G? It is the initialization vector H0 or IV that is being fed. And this is message block 1 of 1024 bits. We'll just look at message block 1. So this is 1024 bits that is coming in, expanded to 80 words. And what is being fed in here? That is the initialization vector is being fed in here. A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. This initialization vector goes through 80 rounds. And after that, we'll get this output, right? A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. After 80 rounds, you're going to get A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. What is that? So this is the output that is shown here. And this output should be added to the initialization vector that we have fed into F. So what is the initialization vector that we have fed in? A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. This should be added with this output. So this is addition modulo 62 per 64. So we are just adding it. That's it. So what is this addition all about? We take a look at that diagram. This is the addition. So what is this addition? The output of this module F is added with the input that is being fed to module F. So this output is just added with the input H0. So what will be the output here? The final output will be H1. So by feeding in H0, we were able to achieve H1. So that is this diagram. By feeding in H0 to our module F and a 1024 bit block, we were able to achieve H1. So what is the use of H1? H1 will be used in the next compression of 1024 bits. So we have achieved H1 here. So now we'll go to M2. Now when block M2 is taken, again M2 will be expanded to 80 words. And these 80 words will be fed into 80 different rounds. And 80 different rounds will give us an output. And what is the input to M2? This will be H1. And we'll be also getting the output of F. We'll be performing an addition with H1. Finally, we'll get H2. Like that, when we take M3, we'll be getting the output as H3. That's what is given here. So I hope now you have understood how this module F works and what is there inside this module. The next question that comes to our mind is, what is happening in a round? We understood what is F, but what are these rounds? What is happening inside each round? We know the input to the round is this buffer A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H that is holding 64 bit values each. So what is happening inside this round? And we also have this word coming as an input. We have a round constant coming in as an input. And the output is nothing but again A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. So we get 512 bit input and we get 512 bit output. And we run this 80 times. We have 80 different rounds here, taking a different word each time and a different round constant each time. So what is a round is the next thing. So we'll take a look at what's happening inside every round. So this is an input to the round. What is an input? A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. So 64 bit each. So 64 bit values are coming in as input. So total input is 512 bits. So this starts with H0, the initialization vector that is being fed, right? That is this part. And what is happening here is we are just doing two computations this entire computation year. This entire computation year, you can call that to be T1. And the entire computation this side, you can call that to be T2. So we are computing something with all these values this side, and we are computing something called T2 with all these values this side. So we'll see what is T1 and T2 and what are the things we do inside a round. So again, what is this round all about? This is what is happening inside each and every round. That is the expansion given here. I hope you have understood this. Now we'll go and see what is this T2 computation, what is this T1 computation, and what other computations happen inside our round. So computing T1. T1 is nothing but H. H is directly from our buffer. That is A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. So we know what is H, and this is a condition function that makes use of three values from a buffer, that is E, F, G. Again, we know what is E, F, G. We should understand this conditional function. And then we are adding that with a function sigma 512 E. We know what is E. E is directly from our input, plus WT. WT is the word from our input text message. So we computed 80 words, right? So it corresponds to the round. If that round is 1, this will be word 1. And K is the round constant. KT corresponds to that corresponding round. If round is 1, this will be K1. Okay, this is T1. Now let us take a look at the diagram and understand what is T1. T1 is nothing but H plus CH of EFG plus sigma 512 of E, and that is added with the word input for that round and also the round constant for that round. So this entire thing corresponds to T1, and that is what is given in the equation here. Let me erase all ink on the slide. So we know what is T1. Now we have to understand what is this conditional function, what it does with EFG. We have to understand what is this function sigma 512E. So this conditional function EFG, what it does is it takes E, performs an AND with F, and XOR that value by performing a NOT E and an AND G. So it's simple XOR AND NOT operations. So we know what is EFG from our input buffer. So we are going to perform E and F, and then XOR that with NOT of E and G. So this is the conditional function. We'll be able to compute this value. We have to understand what is this sigma 512E. Sigma 512E is nothing but we take 64 bits. So this is a 64 bit value, right? Everything is a 64 bit value. So we take E, we write circular shift E by 14 bits. Again, we take the same E, we write circular shift by 18 bits. We take E, we do a right circular shift by 41 bits. We just perform an XOR of all these values. That is this function sigma 512E. So ROTR is called rotate right, or we can say right circular shift by so many bits on the value that is given as input. So now we'll be able to compute T1, right? Because we know what is H. We know what is this function. We know what is this function. This is the input word of 64 bits. And we know this is a round constant, that is an input of 64 bits. So we'll be able to compute T1. So again, all those numbers, hexadecimal numbers you're seeing here are round constants. The 80 different round constants is given here. So we have 20 round constants in a column into 4, that is 80 different round constants, and they are represented in hexadecimal, meaning each value takes 4 bits. So we have 16 digits here, so 64 bits of Brown constant. So our computation of T1 is done. So this part has been computed, that is T1. Now let us compute T2. T2 is nothing but sigma 512A plus majority function that takes ABC. So what is T2? I was telling you this. This exactly is T2. So what T2 does is, it is sigma 512 of A and then this function that takes in ABC. So we have to understand what is this majority function. Majority function takes in ABC. ABC is from our input buffer, right? ABCDEFGH, each is 64 bits. So it's going to take ABC and it's going to perform a simple AND, A and B, XOR that result with A and C, and XOR that result with B and C. So that is the majority function. Let me erase this. And now we have to understand what is the sigma 512A. So what is sigma 512A? It's going to take the value A from the buffer and then it's going to perform a circular right shift of 28 bits of A. Take A, perform a circular right shift of 34 bits. Take A, perform a circular right shift of 39 bits. XOR all the results. So that is this function. So we know what is this, we know what is this, we'll be able to compute T2. So we were able to compute T2. This is exactly what T2 is. And this side, we know that is T1. The next operation that is being performed here is, we take A and then we move it to B in the output. You see, A is taken and then it is just moved to B. So we're just pushing everything one position to the right here. So we take B, we move it as C in the output. We take C in the input, we move it as D in the output. Likewise, we take D. For D, we are doing something different. Before moving it as E, what we are doing is, D is nothing but, this is an addition with T1. So here, what is E? E is nothing but D plus T1. So that's what is given here. What we are doing to D, we are just adding that with T1, the entire result here. So that is going in as E. So we say E is equal to D plus T1. And we have understood all these things. What is D? D is nothing but C from the input. C is nothing but B from the input. And B is nothing but A from the input. This we have understood. Likewise, we are just going to move E to F, F to G, and G to H. So these things represent that. Moving G to H, F to G, and E to F. But we have to compute A. What is this A? A is nothing but the result T2 plus the value of T1. So we compute T2 plus T1 and then we move it to A. So finally, all our computation is done inside a round and we get the output as 512 bits. So what is happening inside a single round? We are computing majority function of ABC and then we are computing sigma 512 of A, and that we call that to be a T2. We are just adding this with this, we say that is T2. On the right hand side, we take this conditional function that takes input EFG and that is added with H. The output is added with H and that is added with sigma 512 of E, and that result is added with the word on the round constant. We say that is T1. So A is nothing but T1 plus T2, whereas all the other values are pushed by one position to the right. That is, A goes to B, B goes to C, C goes to D, like that, so on. Whereas we take D, we add that with T1 and we push it to E. So E is equal to D plus T1. So our round computation is done. So finally, we complete 80 rounds. So we have understood what is happening inside each and every round now. So we have finally understood how SHA-512 works. To summarize, SHA-512 takes in a message of any length and converts that to 1024 bit blocks. And these 1024 bit blocks are then taken a block at a time. So we take 1024 bit block and we expand this to 80 words, and then we feed it to this function or module F. And this module has got 80 different rounds. For each round, we take in a word, and then we also take in a round constant. And we take in an input buffer that is of 512 bits. This is an initial value that we take, a random value, and then we give it as an input here. And this input buffer is processed in 80 rounds with a word and a round constant. And inside each round, we are computing the conditional function, majority function, sigma-512 of E and sigma-512 of A. We are computing T1, T2, and we are performing a lot of operations. After 80 rounds, we are getting this output of 512 bits. The output of 512 bits from the module F, we'll be taking that and we'll be adding that with the input H0 that we have fed into F. So this is nothing but addition modulo 2 power 64. So this output will be 512 bits, and that is H1. So we'll be using H1 in the compression of the next 1024 bit block, that is M2. So again, the same process repeats. You take M2, you convert that into 80 words, and you feed that to 80 different rounds in F, and each round takes in a word and then this round constant. And we'll be calculating this conditional function, majority function, sigma-512A, sigma-512E, and then we'll be performing E is equal to D plus T1 and A is equal to T1 plus T2, everything again. And then we'll be getting the output of 512 bits, and that will be added, and addition modulo 2 power 64 will be performed with H1. We'll be getting H2, and H2 will be propagated to the compression of the next 1024 bits, and again convert M3 to 80 different words, send it through 80 different rounds and 80 different round constants, get an output of 512 bits, perform addition modulo 2 power 64 with H2, that output will be H3, and this H3 will be 512 bits. No matter what is the size of the input, say we have taken 3072 bits of input message, we were able to compress that and we were able to create a message digest of only 512 bits. So no matter what is the size of your input, the output message will always be a fixed size, 512 bits in SHA-512. So I hope you all have understood how SHA-512 works. Thank you.